taking the ghusl. He doesn't have to take the purification bath. He doesn't have to do this. He say, لكن الكافر الأصلي. He say, but the كافر أصلي. The كافر أصلي, meaning someone that was not Muslim before. Right? Someone that was not Muslim before, إذا تاب. If now he take the shahada. إذا تاب here mean, if he now take the shahada. Right? The other one was not, he was a Muslim, but ارتكب كبيرة من الكبائر. طيب, so he embarked upon a major sin from the, among the other major sin. طيب, for this interview we say what? We say تاب, he repented. Right? مكفر, نعم. So therefore, this issue, barakallah, he say, if it is a kafir, that is asli, meaning he was never been a Muslim before. طيب, he say, إذا تاب, if he accept Islam, شوف, he say, فبعض علماء يرى أنه يستغسل, يغتسل. He say that some of the scholars, they see as that he is to be taking a ghusl. Some of the scholars see as him to be taking a ghusl. He say, ولكن الجمهور. But what is that the most predominant among the scholars? They see أنه إذا أسلم الكافر, if the disbeliever accept Islam now, meaning the disbeliever that is أصلي, he say لا يؤمر بالاغتسال, he is not to be ordered to be taking the غسل, he is not to be commanded to be taking the غسل. طيب, he say لأنه, because أسلم, he say because there are أناس أسلم كثير على عهد رسول على عهد نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولم يأمرهم بالاغتسال, because there were many from the companion that accepted Islam at the time of the messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, and the prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام never commanded them to take the ghusl. طيب, so if the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم did not command it, some most of the sahaba that accepted Islam to be taking the ghusl, that shows that it was not something that is wajib. Because if it was wajib, then you will realize that he will command it to every single companion that accepted Islam. That every single one of them, then when after you come say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, that he will command you to do what? To go make the ghusl. But he mentioned here that walakin al-jumhur, what is the most predominant or the most dominant from the scholars? He say, they see that the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, many from the companion accepted Islam, وَلَمْ يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْإِغْتِسَالِ, and وَلَمْ يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْغُسُلِ, he did not command them of what? Of taking the purification bath. طيب, he say, وَبَعْضُهُمْ يَقُولُونَ, some of them other says, he say, إِنَّ الرِّدَّةِ, he say, إِنَّ الرِّدَّةِ تنقض الوضوء. He say that the ridda, apostasy, will, barakallah fikum, break the wudu. Now there is a mas'ala, that is a very important mas'ala, that the father Sheikh Abdul Razak al-Badr, Sheikh Abu Muslim al-Abbad, hafidhahullahu wara'a, hafidhahum Allah, he dealt with in his book that is called Al-Mashi ila Salah, right, by Imam Ibn Muhammad Ibn Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah, and he gave the sharh. Now here is the question he raised. If the person apostates and he come back, is he entitled to his previous actions? Because the verse say what? لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. If you ascribe partner with Allah, طيب, you will be what? All your deeds will be null and voided, and then you will be among the losers. طيب. But now the issue that he raised is, if the person apostate, right, and then he come back to Islam, would he be entitled to all those actions that he has already done, or he already lost it because he apostated? So here Sheikh Fawdan Hafidhahullah, he mentioned that some of the scholars say that if the person, that meaning the ridda, is one of the nullifiers of the wudu. And yes, if you go in some of the books of fiqh, you will find that from those things that will nullify wudu is a ridda. among yani the heavy sleep, among you know using the calling, answering the call of the nature and the likes of this. So they place also a ridda as a nullifier of the wudu. he say hadha bina'an ala anna al a'mal al murtad tubtil walau taba, and they base it on that the action of the person that apostated it, that his action they are batil now, his action they are null and void. طيب ولو تاب, even if he repent, even if he repent. فإذا تاب يبدأ من جديد. Now this is one group is saying, فإذا تاب يبدأ من جديد. If he repent, now he gotta start from scratch now. He gonna go from ground zero now. He gotta start from any fresh new page. All of those deeds he lost it. طيب هذا قول بعض العلماء, and this is the opinion of some of the scholars. والقول الثاني, and the second opinion among the scholars رحمهم الله, is that أن أعماله صالحة بعد توبته, that his action they are still correct after his repentance. The action that was correct, they are still correct after his repentance. After his repentance, that his action are correct. طيب, after that he repent من الردة, after he repent from apostasy, his actions are intact. His action are still there. طيب, ترجع إليه, it will be brought back to him now. It will be assigned back to him now. He say, ولا تبطل, and it is not to be redundant, null and void. He say, now the issue is his wudu. فَيَبْقَى وُدُوءُهُ, that his wudu now remains. And likewise, barakallahu fikum, that actions, the righteous action that he has done, he say, and all of this will be remaining to him, will be returned to him. Meaning the action that he has done will be returned to him. And he say, وَهَذَا هُوَ الصَّحِيحُ, and this is that which is the correct view. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah, he say, whoever from among you, yani apostate from their religion, fayamut wa huwa kafirun, and he died while in the state of disbelief. So therefore, fadalla ala annahu, this verse shows, idha lam yamut, if he doesn't die, وَهُوَ كَافِرٌ, and he doesn't die, and he is not a disbeliever, meaning بَلْ تَابَ, but rather he repented, he say أَنَّ أَعْمَالُهُ السَّابِقَ لَا تُحْبِطُ, that it shows that all of his deeds that were prior will not be redundant, null and void. So therefore, what is the second view, barakallahu fikum? It is more from the scholars that have mentioned that if a person, he say words of disbelief, or he yani apostated, and if he repent, then his action will return back to him. طيب. And there are many verses out, the one that Shaykh Hafidhullah mentioned, right? Many verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مثلاً, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُضِيعُ, that Allah will not put to waste the reward of those who are doing good action. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إيمانكم, Allah will not put to waste your iman, meaning your salah. طيب, because, and exactly this was the issue of the those when the qibla was changed, that those who are concerned about that, okay, how about those who prayed in the other qibla before this qibla was changed? Do they lose all their actions? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this verse. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُضِيعُ إِيمَانَكُمْ, that Allah will not put to waste your belief. Meaning salatukum, as the mufassirin has mentioned. So this was, barakallahu fikum, the end of the questions. And alhamdulillah, I think it was some of the questions, it is enough of alhamdulillah of a sitting, alhamdulillah. وما كان الله جزاك الله خيرا وما كان الله ليضيع إيمانكم جزاك الله خيرا أسي إن الله وما كان الله جزاك الله خيرا. طيب, so we are entering بإذن الله تعالى نبدأ بعون الله وبركته. We are entering إن شاء الله تعالى with يعني the beginning of the book. قال المؤلف. Who's gonna read? حسن تقرأ.
يعلم أن نواقض الإسلام عشرة نواقض. الأول الشرط في عبادة الله تعالى. الشرط في عبادة الله تعالى قال تعالى إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. سورة النساء آية 48. وقال إنه ما يشرك بالله فقد حرم الله عليه الجنة ومأواه النار وما بالظالمين من أنصار. سورة المائدة آية 72. ومنه الذبح لغير الله فمن يذبح
للجن كمن يذبح للجن جزاك الله خيرا. قال المؤلف the Sheikh Muhammad Ibn Abdul Wahhab At-Tamimi, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon him. He mentioned I'lam طيب. He mentioned I'lam. And I think all of us should know I'lam, huh? I think all of us should know I'lam. Right? Not the meaning of it, but why is it used? Adatu ish? Aba asma? Ahsanta, litanbih, to draw the attention. To capture the attention of the one you're addressing, right? To grab the attention of the person you're talking to. And this shows, barakallahu fikum, the usloob, as we were mentioning yesterday, the usloob of Sheikh Muhammad Ibn Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah wa iyyah. How, yani, of a good teacher, how of a good teacher he is. He was, rahimahullah. Tayyib? Huh? Oh, definitely, daiman. But هناك, no. But he always includes it of a dua. And that shows, barakallah fikum. And Shaykh Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, he mentioned it beautifully when he mentioned, i'lam, rahimakallah, annahu yajibu alayna, all the way to that. And he say, when he mentioned, rahimakallah, he said that this is the inaya that the teacher has for the student. The concern and the attention that he has, yani for the good wishes that he has for the student. And this is very important because a teacher that does not wish good for a student will not be a good teacher. Likewise, a student that doesn't have respect for the teacher will not benefit. Right? And this is why you find all the time, barakallahu fikum, the ulama da'iman wa abadan, they will always address the students by making dua for them. And likewise, vice versa, barakallahu fikum. And you always, Sheikh Muqbil Rahimahullah, you will hear one word too, he will say, Barakallah Fiq. Sheikh Rabi Ibn Hadi, Hafidhahullah wa Ra'a, listen to his tapes. One word too, he will say, Barakallah Fiq. One word too, he will say, Barakallah Fiq. One word too, he will say, Barakallah Fiq. Constantly making dua for his students. And this is beautiful, Barakallah Fiq. May Allah allow us to sit under the feet of the scholars of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah and to benefit greatly, barakallahu al-jami'ah. So therefore, the Shaykh al-Islam, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he mentioned, he said, I'lam, know, anna nawaqid al-Islam, asharatu nawaqid. Know, that the nullifiers of al-Islam, they are 10. He said, know that the nullifiers of al-Islam, they are 10. Right, Muhammad. I'lam mean what? to know, but what is it used for? Ahsanta, to draw.